Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. Good morning. I just felt compelled to come to you this morning with that song. This week has been a week full of grace in so many different ways. We started it out as a church in prayer on Monday morning with a prayer line with Pastor Linda, and then we went to serve. We served at Home Sweet Home, and we served at LifeWise. And, you know, what we found there is, yes, we were able to serve, and we enjoyed each other's company, and we got to do some really valuable things, things that were really needed. We unpacked some furniture that had been donated. They have 75 or something bins of furniture. We had a whole truck. They have like 70 more of those that they need unpacked. It's been donated, but getting it unpacked and putting away the recycling and everything is a big deal, and it's not easy. And they need volunteers to do that. And then that afternoon we were at LifeWise. You know, we've donated diapers for their cause, but every week they're giving away hundreds of meals and groceries, and we helped pack about a fourth for one day. There's so much need. And so the grace that was among the people that are putting those bags, making those bags available, the groceries and the people that were putting them together, knowing that it could nourish some people for the week, and that those diapers could help families out, because diapers are expensive, and we've collected those for LifeWise, and we know, and we made an impact as a church for that too. So just so much grace this week, celebrating Pastor Linda's birthday and our collections, well over 100 pieces of spices and 40 books for Ford Elementary with African American Central characters, and you know, just being able to celebrate the peaceful transition of power in our country. So much grace, so much joy. And we just thought the week could be. And through that grace, we've learned that we need to be there to serve more often. So we're gonna start having some regular volunteer shifts at Parkway Pantry and at LifeWise and at Home Sweet Home so we can serve. You know, sometimes it's a little tricky within COVID, but each of these agencies made it really safe. And so our challenge this year is to figure out how to serve and how many service hours we can get and give to the community and give it away. And today, I hope that you'll take your grace and your heart and bring it to worship.
Stand all. down and worship, kneel to the Lord, our Maker. This is our God, our Shepherd. We are the flock led with care.
Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls.
Would you pray with me? Good and gracious God, we thank you for this beautiful morning that you have set before us, Lord. We thank you that we get to come in and worship you again in spirit and in truth. And Lord, we pray for those who are without on today, those who are lacking just the basic necessities of life, food and clothing and shelter, Lord. And we pray your blessing upon them, that you would use us to be your hands and feet to provide for them in amazing ways. And Father, we thank you for this church called Green Trails, who has such a giving heart and a big heart, Lord. And we come to you this morning thankful for all of those who have gathered to worship. Lord, forgive us for those things that we've done that hurt your heart, Lord. We are so sorry for them. We ask that you would turn us around, Lord. Plant our feet on solid ground, that we may be the ones to go out and tell this world about Jesus, that we may be the ones to go out and champion justice and righteousness and all of the things that you call us to do, Lord. Even as we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would you join us in Christ alone? Amen. In Christ we stand. Hallelujah. You know, we've tried many other things. Amen. But it is in Christ that we stand. I don't know about you, but in him we live and move and have our being. Amen. Come on, can we just give God some praise this morning? It's in Christ alone that we find our strength. Amen. Hallelujah, and welcome once again to worship. Amen. This is a beautiful morning that the Lord has set before us. It doesn't matter if the sun is shining or if it's cloudy, if it's raining, if it's snowing. If it's the day that the Lord made, it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood. Hallelujah. Would you pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. For you are our rock and our Redeemer. Speak to us, Lord, and we promise to listen. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we are rounding out our Righteous Resolutions sermon series. We've come a long way since January 1, amen. We talked about a new way, we've talked about a new attitude and a new revelation, and today we're gonna round it out with a new life. Hallelujah. The text is from Galatians chapter 2, verses 19 through 21. Galatians 2, 19 through 21. Hear the word of the Lord. For through the law, I died to the law, so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if justification comes through the law, then Christ died for nothing. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Amen. Some of you may remember back in the day, there was something called soap operas that came on TV. Do those still come on? They're still on? No, okay. I guess I just stopped watching them. But I do remember some. There was All My Children, Days of Our Lives, General Hospital, amen, that was my jam, and One Life to Live. Remember Victoria Lord? She's not still around, right? I don't know. And then there are shows that highlight those who are considered celebrities, like Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, The Real Housewives of whatever city they're doing right now, amen somebody. And what we see are people living their lives, just living their lives out in public. But the question is it real or is it Memorex? Amen. Joan of Arc once said, "One life is all we have, and we live it as we believe in living it. But to sacrifice what you are and to live without belief, that is a fate more terrible than dying," unquote. Some people live as though they have nothing to live for. They have no real belief system, right? Other than doing what they want to do. We see it acted out in the streets of every city across America. People living as if they have nothing to lose. And then there are those who have a firm conviction, a real belief, but the foundation of it is a little shaky. Mostly based on what they think about a thing, right? When you ask them to explain it to you, they stumble and quote stuff that they've read or heard from somebody else. You know, there's a saying, if you don't live for something, you will die for anything. So maybe instead of asking folks, how you doing, we should ask, how are you living? How you living? The Apostle Paul wrote our text to address life lived under the law versus a new life lived in Christ. Judaizers, those were folks who held to the letter of the law, right? Jews who said, you have to follow all of our customs and everything that we say, all of our commands in order to be saved. Judaizers versus the gospel of Jesus Christ, the one who is the fulfillment of the law. So what we're talking about today is a new life in Christ. What does this new life look like? Well, Paul knew this new life. He had lived this new life, right? Remember, he was a Jew among Jews. He knew the law like the back of his hand. In fact, he used to condone the killing of those who dared stray away from the law and follow the way of Jesus. Until one day on the Damascus Road, when his own life was transformed through an encounter with the Lord himself. Paul went from being an accomplice to killing Christians to being an ambassador for Jesus Christ. As he wrote in verse 19, through the law, I died to the law. Now, scholars aren't sure what Paul meant by through the law. He died to the law. But perhaps he meant that he had to go through the law, let it run its due course in his life, and die to it, in order to receive the new life that Christ was offering him. He had an encounter with the risen Savior, and all it takes, church, is for you to sit in God's presence, to be captivated by his love, to receive his forgiveness, and you'll be changed. As Christ was dead to sin, Paul was dead to the law, its effect nullified, thanks to the life-giving force of the gospel. From then on, Paul lived what I call the cruciform life, right? One that is informed by, that lives by Jesus' sacrificial act on the cross. It is a life that is shaped by the cross into a life of the cross. A cruciform life is one that lives vertically for God and horizontally for others. Oh, Paul had a clear picture of this new life. He had to die to his old nature, to his old self, in order to embrace a new life that is patterned after Jesus. And yeah, we have to do the same. If you've ever been to a funeral that had a viewing at the end, sometimes the funeral director or perhaps the pastor, something that my husband and I like to do, will be the final one to slowly close the casket. It is a moving, final act of compassion and care. And when you think about it from a spiritual life and death perspective, we need to close the casket on some things that are keeping us from living the cruciform life. You know, there are just some things that we should be through with. Amen, somebody. Some have tried drinking, marijuana, pills. For some, it's sexual sins. Old folks used to say, there's no fool like an old fool. There are just some things we ought to be done with. 60, 70 years old and you still tripping. Come on, somebody. What do you need to close the casket on? What about anger? Some of us have let anger get the best of us, and now nobody wants to be around you because you're mad all the time. This new life in Christ means that you die to those things that are harmful to you, because your old nature is dead. Jesus nailed that thing, took it all the way to the cross, right? So we've been crucified with Christ relationally. Romans 6:4 says, for we died and were buried with Christ by baptism. Remember, we talked about that a couple weeks ago. And just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glorious power of the Father, now we also may live new lives. We have a new relationship with Jesus. We're now one with Christ, fused by the Spirit, so much so that it is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. It's like a transplanted organ, right? Sometimes the medicine doesn't help, and the organ was dying, and it was in need of a transplant. So Jesus takes our old self, our old organ, that old heart of stone, and gives us a new one, a new way, a new attitude, a new revelation, and a new life. Since Jesus came into my heart, floods of joy on my soul, like the billows, roll since Jesus came into my heart. It's Jesus pumping our heart and filling our lungs and keeping our bodies together. But you know, sometimes the body rejects an organ. The new organ, it just rejects it. And the doctor has to try something else. And sometimes we reject the new life, don't we? Oh yeah, we go back to our old sinful ways. See, Jesus conquered the power of sin, but his presence is still around. Remember, was it last week? Maybe the week before, we did the example of Jesus, you, and sin, and we had glasses up here. I could do a part two of that illustration, because it's true that Jesus conquered the power of sin. You know, when I poured the sin into the Jesus glass, it was gone, right? But we live in a broken world. So sin is still present in the world. It just shouldn't be in us anymore, amen? But really, I could have had a fourth glass of some more sin, amen, and take that you glass and keep pouring it and pouring it. Because sometimes we get on that treadmill and we just go back to our old watering hole. So we need to build our immune system and change our diet. You know, this is a new year, so what are you feeding on? We need to exercise and renew our mind, and don't take God's grace for granted. Either you died or you didn't, amen? We've been crucified with Christ relationally. But also, we've been crucified with Christ daily in our everyday living. We die daily. That's what the scripture says. Sin keeps on tempting. Our flesh is going to be the flesh. So do like Paul. He said, I beat my flesh to keep it in line, 1 Corinthians 9:27. He said, I don't want to be disqualified, so I die daily. We ought to die daily, regularly, often. Amen. You see, we live in these bodies, but your flesh didn't get saved, did it? So it reacts to sin. Have you done anything lately because of sin? Well, let me help you out. Have you complained? Have you worried, murmured, been selfish instead of sharing? Remember when all the toilet paper was gone? Come on, somebody. Have you ever passed up an opportunity to help somebody else when you could have helped them? Yeah, sin makes us do crazy things. We snap up the ones we love and spout off those four-letter words and lean on drugs and everything to the point of addiction. Racism and sexual immorality and theft, they are all rooted in sin. So we have to die. We have to die to it each and every day. And don't think you can skip a day. We don't skip a day of eating, do we? We feed our body, so don't skip a day of repenting because it feeds your soul. See, if we don't repent, if we don't die to ourselves, it's as if we're putting Jesus back up on the cross, as if his dying was in vain. The verse that has kept me sane on my Christian journey is nestled in this passage from 1 John chapter 1, verses 6 through 10. It says, if we say that we have fellowship with him, God, while we are walking in darkness, sin, we lie and do not do what is true. I didn't call you a liar. The word said we lie. Verse 7, but if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. And here's my verse, verse 9. If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and the word is not in us. Church, we ought to be the first ones at the altar, saying I'm sorry, bowing down, laying prostrate before the Lord. Oh, we know what Jesus has done for us. We know where we would be without him. We know that we would be dead in our sin and trespasses if it had not been for the Lord on our side. So what is our response to such great love? Die. Die to the things that keep you bound to the devil. Die to the things that cause heartache and heartbreak. Die to shame and guilt and bitterness. Die to yourself. Then get up and walk in the Spirit. Oh, we ought to be dying daily, amen? So we can get up from there and walk in the Spirit. Last week, we heard Jesus say that the kingdom of God is within you. Romans 10 and 8 says, the word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. Church, we have the words of life and death. We have the kingdom of God within us. We have been given a new life in Christ. So die to those things that hold you back from that life. If you're not happy with your life as it is, may I encourage you to look around. Maybe there's something you need to die to, amen? Because we are crucified with Christ, relationally, daily, and legally. You see, we deserve death. As much stuff as we've done, the penalty, the wages of sin is death. It should have been us up on the cross. But the one who knew no sin became sin for us in order to defeat the power of sin in our lives. Oh, it is the great exchange, and it's hard for us to grasp because we did the wrong. We couldn't pay the penalty, though. So in order to satisfy the righteous requirement of God, it had to be pure, unblemished blood that was shed. So Jesus, our Savior, stepped in. He stayed in relationship with the Father. That's the vertical life. And he stayed in relationship with us. That's the horizontal life. He took my sin and your sin and the sins of our ancestors and the sins of future generations. the sins of the past, the present, and the future. He took them into himself and nailed them to the cross until every last drop of blood left his body. And that would have been enough. But in order to show the surpassing power of God and the deity of Jesus, after being buried for 2 days and two nights, on the third day, hallelujah, God raised Jesus from the dead, conquering sin itself. So now, when God looks at us, he sees us through the lens of the cross. Hallelujah. The cruciform life, church, a life submitted to God and serving our neighbors. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. It is a new life. It is a cruciform life. I'm not turning back, for I've been crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Not I, but Christ that lives within me. I've been crucified with Christ, and yet I live. We don't understand it. It is one of the mysteries of God, but it is the new life. The new life in Jesus. May we all experience that new life. Amen? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Praise be unto God. There may be someone this morning who wants this new life that I've been talking about, right? You're just discovering it for yourself. Maybe you happen to tune in. Maybe you're over somebody's house and they were listening to worship, and you want to know more about this new life. Or maybe you've already been walking with the Lord. But you know how we do sometimes. We walk away. Or sometimes we just go our own way. And if that's you, that's okay. Because God allows U-turns. Amen. Aren't you glad about it? And so you can always come back. Remember, the Jesus glass, the you glass, and the sin glass. Every time you ask Jesus into your life, we are washed in the blood. Amen. Made new. And so I invite you to pray with me this morning that we all may get into this new life, because the change that you want to see in your family, the change you want to see in this world, is only going to come one person by one person. When people of good heart come together, right? When we each experience the new life in Christ. Shall we pray? Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you for what you've done for us. We know we couldn't have done it for ourselves. We know that we were sinners in need of a Savior. And you threw out the lifeline to us, God. You sent your own Son to come and rescue us from us. And we're so thankful for that. So, Lord, for those who are just discovering you for the first time, come into their lives and take control. Oh, we don't want to do the things that we do, those bad things, the things that hurt your heart. We don't want to do them anymore, Lord. So take them, remove them from us, wash us, cleanse us, Lord, and then fill us to overflowing with your Spirit. And Father, for those who may have backslidden, even me, Lord Jesus, because none of us are perfect, we ask for your forgiveness, Lord. We ask that you would renew us, Lord, that you would make us over again, and put us back on that path, that we may leave this place today, whether we're here in the sanctuary or at home or wherever we may be worshiping. Help us to leave from our places and go out into the world and make the change and be the change and be the light that we need in the world. We love you, Lord, and we thank you that you never, ever leave us alone. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. As the praise team comes up, I want to invite you to give on this morning. If you go to our website, there is a giving tab, and you'll see the various ways that you can participate in giving. We believe it is an act of worship, which it truly is, because as they brought their sacrifices back in Bible days, that's what we do every week. We're bringing our sacrifice to the Lord and asking God to bless it and use it. So as the praise team blesses us, pray over what you shall render to the Lord. Amen. Amen.
the price I chose to pay. And to think I ignored what really mattered, 'cause I thought the sacrifice would be too great. But when I finally reached the point of giving in, I found
sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. And I hear the Savior call for daily dying. I will bow beneath the weight of Calvary. Let my hand surrender to his piercing purpose that holds me to the cross yet sets me free. I will glory in the power of the cross. The things I thought worth gaining I can lose. And with the suffering I identify, and by his resurrected power I am alive. I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. Not I, but Christ that lives within me. His cross will never ask for more than I can give.
For it's not my strength but his.
There's no greater sacrifice. For I am crucified with Christ, and yet I live. With God.
Amen. Amen. Bless the Lord. Lord, we thank you for this time of giving. Every time we get to come and give, we thank you, Lord. All things come from thee, and of thine own have we given back to you. So bless our giving, Lord. May it be used according to your will to bless many, locally and even globally. All these things we ask in the name of your precious Son, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Few announcements. If you haven't been able to join us yet, we have a prayer line, hallelujah, on Mondays at 8 a.m. So tomorrow morning, get ready about 5 minutes to 8 and jot down this number if you can, 727-731-7163. If you didn't get it, it's going to be the final slide at the end of worship, 727-731-7163. And that's every Monday at 8 a.m., even on holidays, amen, because prayer doesn't take a break, hallelujah. Bible study will be on Tuesday this week at 7:30 via Zoom. If you want to join in, just go to the website, the link is there, or you can call the church office and we'd be glad to email you the link. You can even call in and hear Bible study. If you'd like to do that, just give us a call at the church office and we'll let you know how. I want to thank you for all of the birthday wishes this past week. Yeah, the country threw me a party on Wednesday, and they do that every 4 years. That's pretty nice of them, amen. But sincerely, thank you so much. It's always a blessing to be blessed by someone, but it's a blessing to be blessed by the children of God. So I know it came from the heart, and I'm sincerely thankful to you. As we prepare to round out this worship, remember, it is not us, but it is Christ who lives in us. So what better song? Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Hymn 364. Say a special thank you to everybody in the music ministry. I don't want to start calling names, I'll forget somebody, amen. And also to Erica and Eric on the AV as well. This is a team effort, amen. And so thank you to everyone. Receive the benediction. Oh Lord, life is worth the living because you live, Jesus, because you live in us. May we remember we have been crucified with you, Lord. And it's not us living, but it's you living in us. So may we go out into this world and tell somebody about the love of Jesus and the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit. Until we meet again, in Jesus' name we pray, amen.